One has heard a lot about Indian writings in English. Truly, the Indian writers writing in English have carved a niche for themselves in the global writing literary scenario and have made significant contributions. People have heard the names of Amita Ghosh or Vikram Seth or Anita Desai or the the Booker Prize Award winner Kiran Desai, her daughter, etc. So the literary pantheon is big and scintillating when it comes to Indian writing in English. The focus of my paper is on what are called Bhasha literatures. Well, the well-known terminology or perhaps the nomenclature for that is the vernacular literatures. But somehow in the Indian, literary consciousness, this terminology, vernacular literatures, has been looked upon as rather a condescending description of the rich multilingual scenario and the way how the writers from the regional languages have contested margins, have interestingly negotiated with the Eurocentric models, etc. So they choose to call themselves Bhasha writers. Okay, so these are the Bhashas of India. Bhasha, actually the Sanskritic origin, etymologically it means languages. Bhashas would be plural. And the Indian constitution officially recognizes more than 18 languages of India, which come from different states of India. Now, with the formation of the seven sisters and the brother, the northeastern states, etc., and if we take the tribal dialects, etc., it would be more than what actually the Indian constitution would officially recognize. But for a very long time, since the eve of Indian independence, these 15 languages constitute, they are given legitimate recognition by the Indian constitution. I hail from a state called Karnataka in South India, and the language of Karnataka is Kannada. About at least 20 to 25 million speakers, speak in Kannada, write in Kannada, and Kannada is an official language of my home state. And the title of my paper, Treading Oblique Paths Across Ideological Grids, is an attempt to chart the context, the historical context of women's literary production in Kannada, and capture some of those interesting voices. And about Kannada heritage, Kannada consciousness vis-a-vis gender positionings and gender politics within the Kannada literary scenario. Well, Kannada language and literature boast of a very seamless and unbroken kind of a literary history for over 1,500 years. The earliest reference to Kannada language in writing is in a stone inscription which dates back to 5th century AD. It was in a place near Hasan, one of the temple towns of Karnataka, renowned for the one of the World Heritage classical sites of temples that were built in the medieval era in the 15th and 16th century by a royal dynasty called Hoysala dynasty. So in this particular place, this stone inscription was traced in the middle of 20th century, and this was called the Halmidi inscription that officially confirmed that Kannada had a hallowed status and the Kannada script was existent as early as in the 5th century AD. Although the stone inscription bears evidence to this, the earliest reference, the earliest literary work in Kannada is around 9th century AD, called Kaviraja Marga, which was actually ascribed to a king, one of the powerful emperors of the dynasty, called Rashtrakutas. And later on it was found that one of the court poets actually wrote it, and for a very long time it was believed the king was the author of this long epic, but later on substantial scholarship unearthed the fact that it was not the king but one of the courtiers, I mean, who happened to be the ghostwriter. And of course Kannada and other, I think other language histories are replete with many of these court poets and writers who adorned the courts of kings and performed the task of ghostwriters and so on. But the point for contention here is, for this kind of a glorious literary heritage, you find that the corridors of Kannada literary establishment were quite hostile to women for quite a long time. And the earliest literary voice that we can actually recapture from the annals of Kannada literary history is the voice of this mystic poetess called Akka Mahadevi in the 12th century. There are fascinating legends about Akka Mahadevi. She is a mystic, she is a visionary, she renounces worldly life and goes away as an ascetic. She wants to be wedded to Lord Shiva and she recognizes Lord Shiva as the one and only consort, and she says, all the men of this world are not men but they are women to me. They represent, because I'm wedded to the husband of all husbands, namely Lord Shiva. And the legends say that Akka Mahadevi is supposed to have left her home naked, saying that she wanted to be completely liberated from all the constraints of this world. And bodily constraint was the least of all these constraints. And she made a statement by removing and casting off her clothes, and she wanders naked. And the legends also describe her as somebody with a glorious kind of mane of hair that that almost covered her anatomical, you know, thing. So this is a legend, and in most posters and you know, the earliest paintings of Akka Mahadevi depict her like that, with her black dresses covering up to her ankle, and not just any part of the body showing. And but Akka Mahadevi goes down in the consciousness of many of the Kannada women writers as one strident voice of literary creativity. And Akka's poems are remarkable for the kind of imagery that they exude, and also kind of a poetic cadence which is greatly cherished by the contemporary Kannada women writers too. One of it is an English translation. Much of it was of course recovered by the study of one Professor A.K. Ramanujan, a renowned poet in Kannada, who taught and instituted a chair for Dravidian languages in the University of Chicago. So he translated much of Akka Mahadevi's poetry. These were called vachanas. Vachanas were pithy utterances, which is actually composed by a mystic in that epiphanic moment of enlightenment. That was how it was actually understood in the Kannada parlance. One thing about Akka Mahadevi's rigorous, unapologetic kind of asceticism: oh brother, have you come drawn by the beauty of these billowing breasts, this brimming youth? I'm no woman, brother, no whore either. Every time you looked at me, who do you take me for? All men other than Channamallikarjuna are faces to be shunned. See, brother. This is how Akka goes. And you have another interesting, this Akka of course is part of, people have a rational explanation for the poetic fervor of Akka. They say, well, she's a product of a extremely insurrectionary intellectual movement in 12th century Karnataka, produced by a band of intellectuals, secular intellectuals, who denounced all caste and other hierarchies of and multiple patriarchy that was actually revolutionized and engineered by a thinking man, a social reformer called Baswanna. And Akka also happened to be part of this movement. So Akka is not just one phenomenon, is what they say. So, but there are contemporary women whose voices also strike out. You have a sex worker from Akka's age, 12th century AD, Karnataka. She calls herself Sule Sankava. Sule actually means a sex worker in Kannada, and it's remarkable and strident the way she foregrounds her voice. She says, I identify myself by my profession as a sex worker, and she addresses herself also as a devotee of Lord Shiva, and she calls Shiva in her poems Nirlajeshwara. Lajja in Sanskrit means shame. You hide yourself because you're ashamed. So she says, Shiva is somebody who transcends these mortal constraints of shame, dishonor, and so on. So she says, he is this sex worker's god. He is my deity. So she says she appropriates Shiva for her own kind of revisioning of her identity, and she addresses him the libertine Shiva. And so in Kannada, it becomes the Nirlajeshwara. So from 12th century Karnataka, there is an ominous kind of a silence, and that's why I kind of call this an oblique path, because it's not a straightforward path. It's a path of subversions. It's a path of strategic reappropriations. It's a path of extremely precarious kind of positionings. How you have to contend with very rigid patriarchal surveillance mechanisms, but at the same time foreground your identity in a variety of ingenious ways. You need to use many camouflaging devices. Perhaps the feminist historiographers really need to unearth more such stories and voices of women, but then maybe it's not sufficiently documented. You find about 16th and 17th, 15th centuries are significant milestones again in Karnataka. We had a pan-Indian movement called the Bhakti movement in India, which takes the Indian socio-cultural imaginary by storm. This is again a revolutionary kind of a movement, which was also envisioned and which happened in different parts of India around the same time, maybe spanning over about 1.5 to 2 centuries, where one democratized the whole notion of religion and the notion of a deity. The notion of a deity got kind of liberalized and democratized in the sense, he is yours, and this companionate God, who is your friend. God is everybody's friend, and he listens to you. This was a kind of a sentiment, upon which the bhakti saints built enormous popularity. You have a mystical saint in Rajasthan, the northern part of India, called Mirabai, and you have Akka Mahadevi this side, maybe in the 12th century. You have 3-4 other very interesting saints from Tamil Nadu called Abbayar, Karaikal Ammayar, etc. And if you notice the lives of these female saints, somehow under the garb of spirituality, they seem to have accessed emancipation. Okay, so if the route to emancipation is through spirituality and by aggrandizing your spiritual self, why not? That also becomes a camouflage. And you find that most of them write haunting kind of mystical poetry. You have a Lal Ded in Kashmir. She is also supposed to have wandered naked across the streets, and she says, for a Lal Ded who fearlessly has gone in quest of Shiva, she will not fear wolves or men or any other predatory animals. But repeatedly you find in their poetry, they invoke, the kind of sexual predatoriness that they had to contend with. And, gender-related injustices are repeatedly addressed. And so in that sense, I think in a way, they're very radically modern in the 13th or 14th century. They kind of, actually take up debates which are resuscitated today in our feminist academia perhaps, but then you find that in many interesting ways they are recast in the literary voices of these women. But if you the examples of course are not very when you examine this tradition, this kind of a hiatus, there are significant voices here and there from the annals of Kannada history. Around 18th century, you find a woman in Kannada called Honnamma. She is employed in the service of the king. These are the women who are there in the palace very often.